Thank you. Thank you so much to Carol, and thanks all of you for coming to this ocean-themed kickoff seminar. I'm really happy to be here, and it's true. Carol is awesome. We worked together for over 20 years. You guys are lucky to have her up in the mountains. The ocean misses her down on campus in Santa Barbara. So as Carol mentioned, it is an enviable position. I have been really fortunate to work with this program called Pristine Seas for over the last decade, and I'm going to talk to you about that work that we've done tonight. So Pristine Seas is an initiative with the National Geographic program, and it's really the brainchild of a really close friend and collaborator of mine, Dr. Enrique Sala. Dr. Sala is a fabulous marine ecologist and photographer in his own right, and he is now an explorer in residence with National Geographic. And he put this program together and put a team together to try to save the last wild places in our oceans. So I don't want to start my talk all negative, and I promise you that I'm going to leave you with some hope in the end, but you may be asking, well, why do the oceans need saving? Why do we travel around to these places? There's a lot of reasons. The oceans are just faced with myriad threats right now. Here's a small list of what we're doing to our oceans: overfishing and destructive fishing, coastal development that can lead to sedimentation. There's just a litany of things that are happening. And this is really a problem because 1 billion people on this planet rely on our oceans for seafood and for livelihoods. And all of us, everyone in this room, we rely on the ocean. The oceans are the largest carbon sink on our planet. The oceans control our climate, controls our weather. So it is a big issue, and that all of this is happening. So we go around, and our team has been witness to some of the changes that the ecosystems are facing because of some of these threats. For example, on a coral reef, we've been watching the decline of healthy corals up in the upper left there, really providing a lot of structure and habitat and color and beauty, through transitions down to corals dying, with the end result here of algal-dominated reefs. We call this in the science field, a lot of people call this the slippery slope to slime. And that's what's happening on a lot of coral reefs. And similarly, we're losing the big fish. Healthy reefs have a lot of sharks and tuna and big fish biomass, lots of weight, lots of predators. And through overfishing and through this decline due to climate and all those other threats that I showed you, we're losing the big fish. Maybe we'll have the small fish, but by the time we've hit that slime reef, we lose all the fish. So we witness these things. And I think I'm going to present to you, I'm going to show you a lot of fun video tonight, but before we get to that, I'm going to talk about what I view as three main challenges that I think are really make ocean conservation a wicked, wicked problem. The first is this. There's no place left in our oceans that humans aren't impacting. Our colleagues at UC Santa Barbara, Ben Halpern and a bunch of people, have made a cumulative threat index, a cumulative impact index. They've measured impact around the globe. And what you see in red and yellow colors are very, very high impact areas. And the blue areas are low impact. But the thing that I want to point out is, well, A, there's not that much left with low impact. There's nowhere left that doesn't have a color. Even 50 years ago, this map would not have been as red and yellow, and there would have been places on this map that had no color at all for no impact. We go everywhere. And this is this index takes into account many of those threats that I listed before. So this is one challenge. There's no place left. The second challenge, I call this out of sight, out of mind. If you look at the little picture of the globe up there with the ocean in the upper left, that's what we see all the time when we see a map, right, of the relative amount of area of the ocean to land. If you just think about surface area. But if you recalculate the amount of ocean based on volume, this is what it looks like. The oceans are deep. This is phenomenal to me. And at this point, people estimate that approximately 95% or maybe even more of our oceans are currently unexplored. So that means we're impacting places that we don't even know what lives there. Most people in the world live, I mean, there are billions and billions of people that live pretty close to the shoreline, 60 or so miles from the shore. Many people in the United States live close to the shore. But even those people who live on the shorelines don't tend to travel further offshore than a few miles, and very few people go deep. And I bring up these challenges because these are some of the challenges that the Pristine Seas model has been developed to try to address. So the third one, the third wicked challenge, is called, we call it shifting baselines. And shifting baseline just means that we as humans, we have this tendency to think about, to sort of categorize change based on a baseline that's usually in our own lifetime or something we know about. So for example, scientists like myself, we might document change from a baseline that was the beginning of my career, not 100 years ago, not 1,000 years ago, a few years ago. So that means that we don't really know, we don't have an expectation of what healthy ecosystems look like because we don't know what, we weren't here and we can't go back in time. But again, Pristine Seas attempts to do a sort of a space for time substitution by visiting places that might still look like they did 100 or 1,000 years ago. So we can shift our own baselines back and not be guilty of this shifting baseline problem. So those are the what I see as pretty major challenges to ocean conservation in general. So this program, Pristine Seas, to try to save the last wild places, these are the main goals, what we do. We try to establish very large, no-take marine reserves, also called marine protected areas. And we do these over the long term. We mainly do, we advocate for large closures in places that are basically remote and uninhabited. But we don't always work in places where there's no people. We also want to help restore the health and resilience of ecosystems using a combination of solutions, including marine reserves, but also fisheries management, better models for fishery management, new ecotourism models. And we do that in areas where there's some human population. We're never going to lock up the whole ocean. We don't want to do that. It's not even desirable. So these are the overarching goals of the Pristine Seas program. So tonight I'm going to show you, because I do work for Nat Geo, so they make amazing films. And Carol kind of said things the wrong way. She said it as if maybe I go out and make the films. That's not me. But I have access to them. I work with the people who do make the films because it's part of the program. So I'm going to show you a lot of videos tonight. And this first one that I'm going to show you now is essentially kind of goes over what Pristine Seas is about. And it will feature Enrique Sala, my colleague and my friend, describing his motivation for starting this really unique program that ostensibly has been quite successful. So sit back and relax, and I'll be flipping to these videos frequently throughout my presentation tonight. And we'll see if it's a good volume or not.
We are defined by the environments that we live in. When they say, where do you come? The first thing that comes to my mind is the reef, the forest, the corals. Maybe that's who I am.
The moment I set my eyes on these remote islands, I know why we're here.
This place is melting like a popsicle in Arizona in the summertime.
Big fish are gone. They have been fished out.
And it only takes a few fishing boats, and they can remove hundreds of years of biomass in just a very short period of time.
After 10 years as a professor, I realized that I was just writing the obituary of the ocean. I quit academia and assembled a team to do something about it.
I want to show to the world what the ocean was like hundreds of years ago, and why we have to preserve them. This is one of these rare places on Earth, a time machine, where we can see the ocean of the past.
What we do is hunt out the last pristine places in the ocean and protect them.
has amazing regenerative power. We just need to let it heal itself.
In one single pulse, in one immeasurably powerful heartbeat, the notion has just changed my life.
So that's the producers call that kind of thing a sizzle reel, but it sizzles a little bit, and it's maybe a little bit dramatic, but it shows you some of the motivation for why, for example, Dr. Sala left academia. He says he was writing the obituary of the oceans. We all work in different places and different ways, and as I said, I'm still a researcher at UCSB. I've stayed in academia, but I've been lucky enough to work with this amazing team on these places. So this is a map of where we've been over the last decade or so, a lot of remote places. You can see the completed expeditions in blue, the places that we have achieved some protection in the green, and there's no, well, there should be some red on there right now. The team is actually down in Malpelo off Colombia right now, and we'll be heading to the Azores in June for a trip. So currently, across the whole globe, only about 3.6% of the world's oceans are protected. And really, less than 2% of those places are in well-enforced and well-managed no-take areas. So we have a long way to go. But the positive note is that when I used to give talks like this less than 10 years ago, I said 0.1% of our ocean is protected. So now we're almost 4. It is hopeful. It is hopeful. And countries are making really, really big moves now to make very large marine protected areas. And I should update that little sizzle reel, is that Pristine Seas has now been involved with partners or single-handedly in preserving about 5 million square miles of ocean habitat. So we're fairly pleased with that. So what, I mean, maybe I should have said this before, but what exactly is a marine protected area? A marine protected area, you can think of it just like a park on land. It's a place in the ocean that is closed, usually to extractive activities, usually to fishing and things like seabed mining. And it's a place that then allows the organisms to grow up big. And when marine protected areas are proposed as fisheries management tools, our hope then is that these big animals will actually swim over the boundary of the MPA or produce babies that transfer over to the outside areas to actually enhance fishing opportunities on the outside of the protected area. So that's what a marine protected area is. Really just like parks in the ocean. So the next series of three videos that I'm going to show you, we made these videos as educational tools to leaders who are attending a very important conference that's happening annually called the Our Oceans Conference. And this is when the true leaders, presidents, whatever, of our countries show up, and they make these commitments, they learn about marine protection, and they make commitments to protecting areas in their countries. And when the Our Oceans conferences started, Pristine Seas thought that these leaders might need some education. So we made a few educational shorts, if you will, and that's what I'm going to show you next. This first one is about marine protected areas. And again, these were for the conference in 2016, but they're still pertinent for today. So let me turn on this little documentary.
Between humanity and the open water, marine protected areas enable the ocean to rejuvenate without human interference. Serve as replenishment zones for fisheries and provide safe harbors for entire ecosystems.
Percent of what the fishermen are catching right now
is from the spillover effect of an MPA. It's bringing tourism into the area. That fish is worth more alive than it is dead on your plate.
Maybe having a marine reserve and building a tourism industry is one way that we can create a future.
Necesitamos desarrollo económico, pero también necesitamos cuidar de nuestro océano. Creo que guardando ese equilibrio es perfectamente posible crear parques marinos.
Stewardship of our ocean is not a one-person event. It's a universal requirement all across this planet.
So all of the vignettes that you see and all of the case studies in these videos come from places that we've taken expeditions to and worked with the leaders and governments. I have to say, I probably should have added it, that these are ocean conferences. It is true that folks like Enrique and some of the others do pit the presidents of countries and the deciders against one another, like my MPA is the biggest. No, mine's going to be the biggest. So it's kind of an arms race right now, but it's kind of one form of an arms race I can actually agree with in this case. But just in case you think that this kind of thing is only happens in these remote islands, these places that I don't know, maybe some of you hadn't even heard of some of those places that we've gone to, California is a leader in marine protection. This is something that Carol and I have been involved with for over a decade, and it took a long time, but through a legislative action called the California Marine Life Protection Act, we recently concluded the implementation of the largest scientifically designed network of marine protected areas, really any, ostensibly really in the world, the amount of science that was used to design this network. Every one of those dots on the map of all of California is some form of a marine protected area. Right now, over 16%, or approximately 16% of the coastline is in under protection. So these are not, you know, and this was a really, really sticky problem. There's a lot of people who rely on the coastline. There's a lot of fishermen. And through 10 years of hard, bottom-up, community-based work, this network was implemented. So these are not, you know, MPAs are not things that are just off in remote places that nobody's ever heard about or cared about. They're going in places where folks really rely on these oceans as well. And actually, Carol and I both, but we do quite a bit of work monitoring these California marine protected areas. So I brought a little brochure of some recent results, if anybody is interested, in what the marine protected areas, specifically in the Channel Islands, which is kind of my home, they were the first set to be implemented, so they're the oldest. So we've been monitoring them, and these brochures are sitting out on the table in the entryway, and I'd be pleased if anybody's interested if you'd like to take one of those. And my contact information is on the back of that as well. Okay, so I kind of hinted a little earlier, or maybe I outright said, is in reality, we're not going to lock up the entire ocean in these no-take marine reserves. That would be a very undesirable thing. Globally, as I said, 1 billion people rely on seafood for their protein, and for a lot of those people, it's their only source of protein. And at least 1/4 of that number relies on the ocean for livelihoods, like fishing and aquaculture. So we do really need to think about fisheries management, but globally fisheries are really in trouble these days. Overfishing, illegal fishing especially, and habitat loss are all causing declines, and that's really resulting in difficulty in food security for those 1 billion people that rely on seafood. The example of no place is unimpacted anymore. What I'm showing here is this is a fish aggregation device. It's these things fishermen put out that free float, and they have a lot of netting underneath, and fish aggregate under them, but they break free of their moorings. And this was wrapped up all over a coral reef. This coral reef was 1,000 miles from the nearest land, and this is what we saw on the reef. Maybe even more dramatic, another atoll that we went to, also over 1,000 miles, 1,000 miles of open ocean from any land, and we saw a gray reef shark with a hook in its mouth. So really, every place is impacted. So we've got to think about fisheries management and rational fisheries management, and people are doing a lot of good work around the globe. So the next video that I'm going to show you is... It talks about achieving sustainable fisheries, but especially the use of really recent technology, and I won't tell you what it is, you'll see it in the video, as well as big multinational, international agreements to combat what's a really difficult problem with illegal fishing. So please enjoy this one about our fisheries.
All the management strategies that we have today were really developed thousands of years ago by the Pacific Islanders. Things like closed areas, closed seasons for spawning, minimum size limits.
Somebody would say like, oh, he's a fisherman. Is he a good fisherman? And the definition of a good fisherman is not somebody who goes out there and harvests everything, but a successful fisherman is somebody who goes out there and takes care of the ocean while harvesting from the ocean.
In the years since the rise of global commercial fishing, 90% of fish stocks have been fished at or above their maximum sustainable yield, proving a desperate need for global, sustainable fishery management.
For years, we've been puzzling over the problem of showing people what's happening way offshore, out of sight, or underneath the surface of the water. And we stumbled across a system of radio frequency broadcasts that can be intercepted by satellites to take all of the commercial fishing activity in the ocean and put it on a map for everybody to see.
Strengthened by satellite-assisted monitoring, international partnerships have grown, sharing data on shared fish stocks.
Before we were acting individually, we were not seeing, we were not knowing. Now, the only way you can fish in our EZ is to be compliant, be legal, and then we can cooperate in a sustainable fishing.
Following in the footsteps of successful regional partnerships, shared management of shared fish stocks went global with the ratification of the Port State Measures Agreement by 36 parties covering 62 countries, and the partnerships of the Safe Ocean Network, agreeing shared frameworks for global fishery management, rewarding the good fishermen, and taking bold collective steps forward toward the rhythms of our sustainable past.
We in the West are just starting to realize the frailty and the finiteness of the ocean.
When you decide that this is your priority, it must be reflected throughout the system. It's our life. The ocean is our life.
That speaker that you're seeing, that woman that you're seeing in a lot of the videos, is a collaborator from the country of Palau, which has done quite good work in sustainability. So finally, we really can't talk about ocean conservation and management without bringing up this issue of climate change. It's an umbrella over everything that we do. It's changing our systems so dramatically in so many different ways, but perhaps maybe the most dramatic and something that you almost can't avoid it in the news these days is this rapid decline and death of large portions of the really iconic Great Barrier Reef. in Australia. Here's a few of the headlines, but it's starting in about 2015. Large portions of that reef started overheating, causing what's called coral bleaching and ultimately death of the corals. The Great Barrier Reef is just, like I said, it's iconic, it's huge, it provides livelihoods for plenty of Australians, and through tourism just affects really the whole world. Here's a couple maps showing this coral bleaching. In 2016, the northern part of the Great Barrier Reef was hit quite hard. They thought maybe that would recover, but in 2017, the bleaching really hit the central part. And you can see an example here of what a coral reef looks like when it's healthy and has all of its color, and then a bleached coral. And this bleached coral will eventually die, and algae will, it's the slippery slope to slime again. So this has been really in the news a lot lately. And this final video that I'm going to show you, it does talk about climate change and the reef. And you're going to hear from, in this video, you'll hear from our colleague, Dr. Terry Hughes. He's a really, really eminent coral ecologist in Australia. And, you know, you can tell me if I'm imagining it, but he's been working his whole life on the Great Barrier Reef, but I think I hear just utter despair in his voice. So let's put this one on. I promise you we will go positive at some point.
We've now had three major bleaching events on the Great Barrier Reef. In 98, 2002, and again just recently in 2016. We zigzagged along the whole length in a helicopter and fixed wing plane. We put about 100 people underwater. The extent and severity of this bleaching is off the chart. Typically, a bleached coral is nutritionally compromised. But this time around, we discovered an additional phenomenon. Many of the corals we surveyed were already dead. They actually cooked. And that's because the temperatures this time around were so extreme.
Already in 2016, severe coral bleaching has also been recorded across the Pacific Ocean, in Fiji, across the Indian Ocean, in the Maldives and the Seychelles, and even in the southern Red Sea. Similar events are predicted across the Caribbean and Micronesia, in a year in which the impacts of heat stress on the global ocean have reached unprecedented extremes. As the distribution of marine species continues to change, as storm surges continue to intensify, as sea ice and glacier melt accelerate, and as sea level rise and human displacement intensifies.
Countries around the world, in Paris last year, have committed to a rapid transition away from fossil fuels towards more sustainable, renewable energy.
Paris marked the moment when the world finally decided to heed the ever-rising mountain of evidence that had been piling up for years, and began instead to galvanize our focus.
S'il y avait une seule chose à réussir pour appliquer l'accord de Paris, c'est la réduction des émissions de gaz à effet de serre. Pour augmenter la résilience de l'océan, il faudrait bien sûr lutter contre le réchauffement climatique, donc monter en puissance sur les énergies renouvelables, y compris les énergies renouvelables marines.
So on an unfortunate note, the Great Barrier Reef has not really, the situation has not improved there since these videos were made and since 2016 and 17. But on a more positive note, that predicted wide-scale bleaching across the entire Pacific was not as devastating as many of us thought it was going to be. So that's a positive note. Many of those reefs recovered quite rapidly, and the sea temperatures were not as high as expected. So that's on a more positive note. So let's bring this back to pristine seas a little bit. I mentioned a few times this sort of pristine seas model. So I want to go over some of the tools that we use and what this model is and why it has been successful as it has. One of the things that we really do is incorporate technology and technology to explore parts of those oceans that were out of sight and out of mind. Submarines, deep, specially built deep sea drop cameras and drones that are getting more typical now all through science. And this gets us offshore and gets us into those environments that have been previously pretty difficult to explore. And we use that technology not only for the filmmaking, but for the scientific research, which is a key component of the Pristine Seas model. And that's, I say that because that's the team I'm on. When I go, I'm on the part of the science team. I'm basically the fish counter for Pristine Seas. And we do a lot of very traditional science, but we do it on in these remote places with specially built teams, and we use some of the technology for that as well. So the science, it may not seem as glitzy as the films that are being made, but I will tell you that it's a really important part of this project, in that we guide the filmmakers into what's interesting. We guide the policy. We tell the policy folks what to talk to the presidents about, what's special, what's unique, what's scientifically valuable about the places that they are, that they have, why they should be protected. The film and imagery, okay, yeah, that probably is ostensibly the most important thing, but what we try to do is we always have a production and film team with us, and we make feature-length films. We make a lot of these shorts that you've seen tonight, but we make feature-length films, and we do it on very, very fast timelines. The science is done quickly and analyzed, the reports are written, the papers are written, the films are made on fast timelines, and that's so that we can present all of this to the policymakers, to the stakeholders in the places that we go. Some of the deciders may end up being the president of a country, but some of the deciders are often the locals in the islands that we're at. This image on the right shows a big potluck meal we were sharing with folks who live on Pitcairn Island, Pitcairn of Mutiny and the Bounty, where they had a lot of say in what marine protection was gonna happen in their area. So the outreach and the policy is a really, really key component as well. So the last bit of this presentation, I'm going to finish up in the next 5 or 10 minutes. I'm just going to take you on two of our recent expeditions that we went on by showing you a couple of these short documentaries that we made. The first place that we're going to go is this country called Niue. Has anybody ever heard of Niue? No, nobody. Okay, that's not surprising. Niue is about 1,500 miles or so northeast of New Zealand. It's a place, it is its own country. It has about 2,600 people that live on it. And we actually went to Niue. We went there in 2016 at the invitation of the folks from Niue who had been wanting to establish some marine conservation areas and do some marine protection. I'm happy to say that just last year at that same Our Oceans conference, the one where the leaders go and go on about the size of their MPAs, the government of Niue announced that they were going to protect 40% of their EEZ. And for those of you who don't know, the exclusive economic zone, that's 200 miles offshore of the island. So 40% is a very big area. It's about 127,000 square miles of protection, including a reef that was the target of our expedition called Beveridge Reef. It's about 150 miles from Niue, but it's part of their country. It's part of their EEZ. And we discovered that in this place, Beveridge Reef had the highest biomass of numbers and sizes of gray reef sharks pretty much in the world that we had ever seen. So Niue has now got this protection, and these videos that I'm gonna show you, this one and the next one, are just, I just want you to sit back and relax. There's no, we can talk about them, you can ask me questions later, but just enjoy. So this is Niue, tropical. Okay, so that's Niue. And I should have mentioned, the reason we make these short little films, we do these things while we're actually on the expedition so that we can have presentations and meetings with people on the islands before we go home. So these short clips are used for that purpose so that people can see what we do. We often work with the locals as well on the boat, but in cases where we don't, or even in cases where we do, we like to go back to the communities and show them what we've done, what we've accomplished during the trip. So that's what these little short films are about. Okay, so the final mini expedition I'm going to take you on tonight is to a very, very different place, Tristan da Cunha, which is in the Atlantic Ocean right here. I can't even say like, oh, it's, you know, the closest land, because the closest land is actually, I think the closest land is 2,000 miles away, and that's another small island called St. Helena. Tristan da Cunha is the world's most remote inhabited island. There is a community there of about 262 people, unless they've had births or deaths since we left. We went there in January and February of 2017. So Tristan da Cunha and its associated islands, Nightingale, Inaccessible, and Gough Island, are a really, really special place. They have already, they're a UK overseas territory, and they've already garnered a lot of international attention and being named a UNESCO World Heritage Site, and that's mainly because they're so important for seabirds. The Southern Ocean is known for a lot of seabird nesting, and there's even an endemic albatross that's endemic that only breeds in the Tristan Islands. So they'd already been recognized for these sorts of land and seabird conservation, but no marine protection to speak of. So Tristan da Cunha's status now is we completed the expedition, and the UK is currently looking at marine zoning and marine conservation projects across all of their overseas territories, the UCOTs we call them, UK Overseas Territories, in something that they've called the Blue Belt Initiative. So this is one that's ongoing. We're still having conversations, we're still meeting with the UK government, and we're still working with the folks who live on Tristan da Cunha, and their livelihoods, you know, are there, and they depend on being on that island. We're still working with them. The goal is to have marine protection, some form of marine protection in place by 2020. So this one is ongoing. This is somebody asked me in the lobby, where's the most remote I've been? This is it. It was 9 days one way on a ship from Cape Town, South Africa. And we were lucky, apparently, because it can take like 13 if you have bad weather, one way. And that's the only way that the locals can get on and off. There's no airport, there's no flying to Tristan da Cunha. So I would say this one is by far the most remote place. So hopefully by 2020 we'll have something going there. So please enjoy. It's a temperate ecosystem, and you may recognize the giant kelp. It's the same species we have in California.
Thank you.
That was a really special expedition. It was definitely one of our largest and most multidisciplinary. There's a lot of seabird work already going on. We worked very closely with the locals. It's a really special community, 262 people whose lives depend on that rock they're living on, and their fisheries and so forth. Okay, so that kind of concludes the expedition video part of our presentation tonight. And I just want to conclude with, yes, I am fortunate. Yes, I do get to work with people like Enric Sala and go on these expeditions, but it's not every day of my life. Most of my days are in my office in Santa Barbara. And so, you know, I ask myself and people ask me, well, what can we do? And these are just a few of the things that, you know, we can do, that you can do every day if you need to, if you want to. To protect the oceans and to protect other ecosystems as well, these mountain, these incredible lake and stream ecosystems you guys have up here, and watching our carbon footprint, minding making smart seafood choices, reducing plastics, and generally supporting ocean organizations. So I'm going to conclude there, but I'll leave this slide up. That's just a few of the resources that, you know, well, how do we make good seafood choices? There's really good, you know, you can look on the intrawebs. There's lots of really great resources out there. Seafood Watch is one of them. If anyone is more interested in that big map I showed of global impact, that's the Ocean Health Index there in my labs and Pristine Seas for more, if you want to see more video like this. So I'll stop there, and I hope you enjoyed the little quick tour of the world, and I'd be happy to answer questions.
All right. Thank you, Jen. What I'm going to do is...
Okay. You know what, though? I also made... Did you guys like the imagery? Because I made a little slideshow that I can rotate while I'm answering questions. Are you interested? You're not overwhelmed with imagery yet? Okay, let me see. I made just it's quick and it's only a few slides, but we'll just put this one on and make it play in the background, and then I can answer questions.
Okay, first of all, I want to thank Jen, and I also want to say, as much as I miss the oceans, I'm really glad to know that there are people like Jen out there that are doing this sort of work, because I think it's so important. Questions for Jen.
Well, I have one.
Okay.
We're from Ventura County, and so my sons and grandsons fish out around Santa Cruz in a cap, and they have a radden.
Nice, I have a radden too. It's passed.
One time, they got in a sanctuary and they got into a lot of trouble. So they are aware, but what's the story on the sanctuary? I mean, is it working?
Yeah, so the question was, this gentleman's sons fish out of Ventura and fish the Santa Cruz Islands, the Northern Channel Islands, where I work pretty extensively. And as I showed you, there's a big network of marine protected areas that went in there. And this gentleman mentioned the sons actually accidentally getting into the reserve and getting in some trouble when they were fishing. And the question was, what are they doing? Are they working? And we get that question a lot. So yeah, the simple answer actually is in the brochure that you can pick up outside, but I'll tell you what it is, which is, they are working, depending on how you define working. When you stop fishing, this is not actually rocket science. When you stop fishing, fish grow big and they live. So many of the marine protected areas, especially down towards Anacapa and Santa Cruz Island, which are more heavily fished areas than, say, San Miguel, which is more distant, are accumulating bigger fish and more fish in those reserves. The jury is still out on whether we're getting that spillover effect that was mentioned in one of the videos and that I hinted at as well, whether the biomass is building up enough in those reserves to spill over and actually enhance fisheries on the outside. I work with a lot of commercial fishermen and a fair number of sport fishermen, and I will tell you that at least for the lobster fishery, the California spiny lobster, those guys are pretty stoked right now. Their fishing is really good. They're trapping right on the edges of the reserves, which is perfectly legal and actually pretty smart. Because, you know, if you're going to get them when they're spilling over, get them right over the line. So lobster fishery is doing okay. And but we just don't have enough data yet on all the other, and they haven't been in place long enough. So hopefully the state will continue to support us in the monitoring for another, for the rest of my career, and yeah. So you were next, yeah. Yeah, that's a great question, and I really didn't talk about ocean acidification. Carol can actually talk about ocean acidification even more than I can. But what that refers to is our oceans, through chemistry and through more carbon, are becoming acidified, okay? And this is really detrimental for any animal that uses calcium carbonate to make a shell or to make a coral skeleton. And so ocean acidification, many people think it's actually the worst thing that's happening to our oceans from climate change, and that it could just kill the basis of entire food webs. So the question was, you know, what about ocean acidification and the marine protected areas? Is it uniform throughout them? The scales at which this chemistry acts are much larger than the scales of the MPAs in the places like California, these relatively small MPAs. So that's one of the reasons why we like the idea of a network of MPAs, because what we're doing by putting them in all different areas is it's insurance, basically, right? We're diversifying the portfolio. So if one gets impacted by ocean acidification or gets impacted by storms or whatever, we've got other ones in place, and that they're, hopefully they're connected through dispersal and can seed one another. The really big, big MPAs that are being put in place globally, that are, you know, hundreds of thousands of square miles, they're going to have a mosaic of different types of ocean acidification and other impacts that are happening. They're so big. But those places are far less well understood and less studied. Yeah, we can monitor a small California MPA. We can't exactly monitor every mile of 127,000 square mile MPA. Those corals that you saw dying, that was heat.
The Great Barrier, that's from
heat. That's heat stress, straight up. The temperatures are just out of whack right now. Yeah, yeah.
So some months ago, the administration was talking about the list of national monuments and national marine reserves and whether they would be changed or minimized or reduced. Where are we on that?
Well, it's not good. Attention, we think attention is going to turn quickly to the marine ones. We think that this administration got a little caught up with Bears Ears and Utah and the other places. And now that they are succeeding in selling that off rapidly, they're going to turn their attention to the marine ones. So we're gearing up for some pretty big battles right now, especially in, this would only be in the U.S., so it's the Northwest Hawaiian Islands, a place that's near and dear to my heart, Palmyra Atoll, where I do a lot of work, which is about 1,000 miles south of Hawaii, but it's a U.S., it's part of the Pacific Remote National Wildlife Refuges. So nothing has happened yet. I think like most of these actions, there'll be some pretty big lawsuits that will slow things down, but we are behind the scenes gearing up pretty big time right now, because we do think that's going to be the next, I think the focus is going to go on the marine ones real soon. But I was going to end on a positive note, but you brought it up. Yeah, well, you know what the positive note is? We're not going to let it happen. We're just not going to let it happen. We work too hard to get those places in, and yeah. Yeah.
I was down in Mexico at Cabo Palma.
Oh, Cabo Palma. Yeah, so the question, difference between a marine protected area and a marine reserve, people use a lot of different language around marine protection. We think we have a definition, although I'm just as guilty. I probably went interchangeably between the two terms throughout my presentation tonight. But a marine protected area often can allow some sort of usage or some sort of take. We are pushing the whole world, if we can, to use marine reserve for a no take, no fishing. And that's the only difference. But The UN made 6 different designations. Every other country uses different terminology. And there are uses allowed in marine protected areas, and those are often some fishing. Our California ones, we have lots of multi-designation protected areas that allow certain types of fishing. Yeah, but a marine reserve should be a no-take. Yeah. Cabo Pulmo is a no-take. And it's one of the, it's the poster child for amazing response in fish biomass. It's an incredible place. You're lucky to get to go there. Yeah, super lucky. Yeah, I think you're next, and then maybe you. Yeah.
Okay, it's kind of a two-part. You said early on that the ocean will heal itself.
Actually, my colleague said that, but I do believe it.
Okay. What's the timeline for that, and what sort of withdrawal from extraction, pollution, and involvement is required to facilitate that? And the second part is of the nations internationally that impact detrimentally the ocean, what sort of support is there for the pristine ocean movement?
Okay, so let's take the first part, which is more of a scientific answer. The first question was, okay, we had said, hey, the ocean can heal itself if you just give it a rest. And that is true, and it certainly was probably more true 20 years ago before things like ocean acidification and some of the larger climate change effects since that train left the station. The question was, well, what do we have to do? What sort of scale would that happen? How much time? What's needed? It's going to depend on the different... It's obviously gonna. I hate it when scientists do this, but it's complex. But basically, for near shore places, let's just take California or the Great Barrier Reef, for example. If you want populations to come back again, then you have to stop killing those animals. You have to stop fishing those animals or removing them. But key to them regenerating on their own are, A, we leave enough to regenerate, and B, make sure their habitats are still there. So once habitats are destroyed, it's not really going to matter whether you stop fishing or not, because these animals aren't going to have a place to live even if they do come back again. And that's what we're probably most concerned about now, is that some of the bigger effects like ocean acidification, like the coral bleaching, those are now starting to destroy the very habitats that the animals depend on. So it's not really going to matter that much what you do about fishing or other if they don't have anywhere to live. The time frames, of course, are going to be totally different depending on whether you're talking about some of the tuna fisheries, big collab, you know, out these big MPAs with big offshore areas and big fisheries versus faster growing coral reef fish on coral reefs. And it can be anywhere from, I mean, we've seen amazing responses just at Anacapa Island in a decade. So, yeah. Okay, the second was around, and correct me if I don't get this quite right, but around what sort of international support is there to countries, sort of? Are you saying sort of like policy support or political support or management of those really large, you know, the pristine areas and the protected places? Is that?
I understand that policing.
Yeah. Enforcement.
Automatic.
That's right.
At a national level, are we seeing a lot of countries which have negatively impacted our oceans taking a position that might be supportive or parallel to?
Yeah, there's a really good example right now. So have we seen countries that maybe have been doing a lot of extractive activities, are they taking stands now on protection? Or, yeah, for example, Indonesia, they have been blowing up illegal fishing boats, literally blowing them up. I mean, they get the people off and everything. I'm assuming they get the people off. But and then what they're doing is they're putting these boats out in a harbor and for everybody to see, because that's what happens if you illegally fish their area. Unfortunately, Indonesia also did and does a lot of illegal fishing as well. Palau has blown up a few boats. So some countries have made some pretty dramatic efforts towards combating this sort of illegal fishing. But that video that showed you, this Global Fishing Watch, the automated tracking of boats through what's called the AIS system that all these bigger boats have to run now, it has, and this is all really, really new, hot off the presses stuff. Global Fishing Watch has only come about in the last 2 years, and the data are publicly available. This has broken open the idea of, and allowed, probably for the first time, remote enforcement. So now countries, you know, like Tristan da Cunha, like Niue, they don't have boats. They can't go monitor their whole EEZ. Now can collaborate with countries that have access to the, or everyone has access to this AIS data, and figure out when fishing boats are making incursions, illegal incursions, into their EEZ. But that's only one part of the enforcement story. And the reason that I know this so well is because we actually take a lot of flack from a lot of people in the scientific community about these big MPAs. They say that they are useless because they are unenforceable, and that they're worse than having no MPA because they draw resources away from places that could be better managed or could be enforced. So this Global Fishing Watch data, and the fact that we can track vessels now, is big. But the second part that's going to have to happen is agreements like the Port States Agreement. So it's one thing to say that, okay, well, we saw a signal of a boat in our EEZ. You have to get that boat when he tries to offload the fish at a port. And that's a sticky problem right now. So there's still plenty of countries out there who, you know, there's basically countries that don't even have governments right now that have ports that will take in these illegal boats. But once everybody's on board with, once there's nowhere to land those illegal fish, we're going to know where the boats are, and they're not going to have anywhere to offload those fish and sell them. So that agreement is the second part. Sorry, that was a really long answer to your question, but something I'm passionate about. Yeah. Because we do have to fix this problem. We do have to be able to enforce if we're going to do these big MPAs. Yeah. We don't want them to be useless.
For example, I noted that in support of some of these, we saw Somalia. What are they doing?
Yeah. Somalia, Sudan land a lot of illegal fish right now, but you can't really blame them. They don't even have a government. So, yeah, they're lawless. Yeah, so it's going to be tough.
One more question? Was there one more over here?
One more. Oh, yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Two parts. One is on some of the schooling fish, I presume there's a certain density needed for them to survive. And are these preserves going to be enough to allow that? And the second part is, what effect is aquaculture?
Yeah, good questions. Okay, so the first one, again, is the easier one because it's more scientifically answered. The for schooling fish, and maybe I think you mean too for other big mobile fish, you know, will these places be big enough to protect them? Marine protected areas are only going to protect fish that stay within their boundaries or stay a good part of their life within their boundaries. So we know very well which species they're likely to protect and which ones they're not. When you put in a marine protected area, it's not a panacea. So, you know, we know a whole bunch of species that have really small home ranges and they're likely to spend their whole life in the MPA. Those are the ones likely to respond. The small MPAs in California, they're not going to protect tunas. They're not going to protect whales. They're not going to, you know, they're not going to protect dolphins, things that swim a long way. So that's just a matter of knowing how much do fish move and designing an MPA around what you want to protect based on the movement. And that'll differ based on the species. The second question, and I'm glad you brought this up as well, has to do with aquaculture and maybe what effect that's having on you know, the ocean environment and so forth. The aquaculture story doesn't play in so much to the kinds of MPAs and the kinds of things I talked about tonight. These are mostly offshore and big areas. But aquaculture is becoming increasingly important to provide fish protein for a lot of people in the world. It's going to start taking off in places like California as well. So a lot of people it's really out of my area of expertise. A lot of people, though, are out there, a lot of smart people, are thinking hard about how to design ocean aquaculture to be potentially less damaging than it has been in the past. So there's a lot of people working on best practices. Someone that Carol and I used to work with a lot, Steve Gaines, he's the dean of the Bren School, is working quite a bit on aquaculture, and he boils it down to pretty simple, which is we need to do aquaculture for things that are low on the food chain. Filter feeders, oysters, mussels, you get double bang for your buck. They're cleaning the water, and we're eating them. So, yeah. So, thanks. Okay.
Well, I would like to